to eat this Passover with you before I suffer. For I say unto you, I will not any more eat thereof until it be fulfilled in the kingdom of God. And he took the cup and gave thanks and said, take this and divide it among yourselves. For I say unto you, I will not drink of the fruit of the vine until the kingdom of God shall come. And he took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it unto them, saying, this is my body which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. Likewise also the cup after supper, saying, this cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you. Let us pray. Father God, we come to you today, Lord, and Lord, we just thank you again for the opportunity to be here. And Lord, for the opportunity to come to your table. And Father God, I just pray that you would just open up our hearts, Lord. Allow us to see the significance of what is about to take place. Lord, help us to see the reverence that it demands. And Father God, just like last week, I pray that you'll just pour out your grace upon us. Lord, as we observe this second ordinance that you've commanded us to do. And Father, I pray that you would just have freedom in the room. Lord, open our eyes, open our hearts, illuminate our souls to your truth. And Lord, the magnitude of what is about to take place. And Lord, why it's been instituted by your beloved Son. Lord, we just ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Now, to begin with this morning, I want us to look at where communion originated from. And as we can clearly see here in our text this morning, communion originated from Christ during the Passover meal on the night before his crucifixion. Again, we're told in verse 7, then came the day of unleavened bread when the Passover must be killed. And Jesus sent Peter and John, saying, go and prepare us the Passover meal that we may eat. And they said unto him, where would you have us prepare it? And he said unto them, behold, when you enter into the city, a man shall meet you, bearing a pitcher of water. Follow him into the house where he enters. And you shall say to the goodman of the house, the master says unto you, where is the guest chamber, where I shall eat the Passover with my disciples? And he shall show you a large upper room furnished, make that ready. And they went and found as he had said unto them, and they made ready the Passover meal. So on the eve of the crucifixion, Jesus and his disciples are gathered in this upper room celebrating the Passover meal. Now the Passover was a special meal designed by God to commemorate Israel's deliverance from Egypt. And you know the account, how God brought all these various plagues upon Egypt that were meant to free the Israelites from the bondage that they had endured for centuries. And we read how Pharaoh continued to harden his heart. He continually refused to let the people go. And when the Lord had enough, the Bible says he sent one final plague that would take the life of every firstborn in the land. And in order for the nation to protect themselves from all this judgment and all this impending death, each household had to kill an innocent lamb. A lamb without spot and without blemish. And then they had to rub its blood on the doorpost and the lintels of their homes. And then they had to take this innocent lamb, this lamb that they just slaughtered, and they had to roast it and eat it along with some bitter herbs and some bread. And this meal that they ate later became known as the Passover meal. And it's called the Passover meal because the angel of the Lord that night passed over those whose homes were covered in the blood of the Lamb. So God put in place this annual feast to serve as a memorial which helped the people remember how God delivered their nation, the nation of Israel, out from the bondage of the Egyptians. But on this night, the night before his crucifixion, Jesus took this ancient feast and transformed it into a meal with new meaning. Now, according to Jewish tradition, the Passover meal would have began by the host, or in this case, Jesus, pronouncing blessing over a cup of red wine. And this wine was symbolic of the blood of that innocent lamb that each household had to slay on the night of the Passover. Then that was followed by the eating of these bitter herbs. And these bitter herbs symbolized the bitterness that the Jewish people endured while they were under the bondage of the Egyptians. And then they would have took a little bit of unleavened bread that night, and they would have dipped it in a fruit sauce and passed it around. And finally, the roasted lamb would have been brought out, and they would have enjoyed it together. And while they were eating this meal, there in the upper room, the Bible says that Jesus did something extraordinary. He reinterpreted the bread and the wine in terms of his body and his blood that would be shed on the cross. He broke bread and passed around another cup, instructing his disciples to eat the bread and drink the cup in remembrance of him, because he is the Passover lamb. In this moment, Jesus was putting in place a new memorial. A new era had begun. From this day forward, the exodus from Egypt would no longer be the greatest redemptive event in history. It was about to be superseded by the cross. And as the Lamb of God, Jesus was about to become the ultimate Passover sacrifice. And this morning, if you want God to pass over you on the day of judgment, you must be covered in the blood of Christ. That's what it represents. So communion was instituted by the Lord on the night before his crucifixion during the Passover feast. But what does it represent this morning? Well, the bread quite simply represents the body of Christ. Look at what we're told in verse 19 of our text. We're told that Jesus took bread and gave thanks and broke it and gave it to his disciples and said, "This is my body, which is given for you. This is my body, which is broken for you." So the bread represents the body of our Lord and Savior. Now, in Jewish culture, the body represents the whole person, the entire individual. So here it symbolizes Jesus' entire life. Christ was born and crucified and resurrected as a sacrificial gift to all mankind. It represents his life from the incarnation when he come down from heaven to his resurrection from the grave. That's what it represents. It represents the life of Christ, a life that was broken for you. Broken for you. So that God would ultimately pass over your sins on the day of judgment. And we'll all face that day. Now, the cup represents the blood of the new covenant. Look at what we're told in verse 20. We're told, "Likewise, also Jesus took the cup after supper, saying, 'This cup is the new testament. This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is shed for you.'" So what is this new testament? What is this new covenant that Jesus is referring to here? Well, this new covenant is spoken of way back in Jeremiah chapter 31, centuries earlier. Listen to what we're told. Listen to what Jesus is referring to in Jeremiah chapter 31, beginning in verse 31. He says, "Behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers in that day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they broke, although I was a husband unto them, saith the Lord. But this shall be the covenant, this shall be the new covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, saith the Lord, I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people." This is the new covenant that Christ is referring to here in the upper room. This is the promise that God made to all mankind way back in Jeremiah. He says, "I promise that I'm going to bring about something new. A new covenant where I will write my law upon your hearts so that I can be your God and so that you could be my people." And in order for that to happen, in order for us to become God's people, our sins must be forgiven. And the Bible says, in order for sin to be forgiven, blood must be shed. We're told in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 22, "And almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without the shedding of blood there is no remission." Without the shedding of blood, there is no forgiveness of sin. Under the old covenant, forgiveness required the continual sacrifice of innocent animals. The blood of innocent animals had to be continually shed. That's what ratified the old covenant. It's similar to a modern day contract. Think of it in those terms. A contract today is ratified by your signature. That's what makes it official. That's what makes the contract valid. And the same applied to the old covenant. God's forgiveness was only valid through the blood of innocent animals. That's the only thing that validated his forgiveness. But the same thing cannot be said of the new covenant. The new covenant was ratified by the blood of Christ. In effect, on the cross, Jesus took his blood and signed on the dotted line. He signed his signature in order to ratify the new covenant. In that moment, a new covenant, a new era was ushered in. It was fulfilled once and for all by the sacrifice of Christ. And here in the upper room, Jesus says, "This is what the cup represents." This is what it represents. It represents the blood I'm sacrificing in order for this new covenant between God and man to be established. Understand the significance of it. It is the blood of Jesus that provides the forgiveness of sin that Stephen talked about earlier. Only the blood. It is the blood of Jesus that ushered in this new covenant that God spoke about, that God said was going to happen way back in Jeremiah. It's the blood of Jesus that provides a way for God to write his law on our hearts. It is the blood of Jesus that allows us to become God's chosen people. This is what the cup represents this morning. And Jesus tells his disciples here in verse 15, and catch it, "I've been waiting a long time for this moment." He says there in verse 15, "With desire, I have desired to eat this Passover with you before I suffer." Jesus says, "I have desired this moment for all of eternity. This moment when I will wipe away the old covenant system and usher in something new, something better, something that guarantees forgiveness once and for all. I desire to do that for all 12 of you and everyone that would follow." This is what the bread and the cup represent. Which brings us to a third point this morning. And that is, what is the purpose behind communion? Well, communion serves as a memorial to Christ. That's the purpose of it, to memorialize Christ. Just as the Passover meal memorialized God delivering the children of Israel from the bondage of the Egyptians, communion serves as a memorial to God for delivering us from the bondage of sin. And during this memorial, Jesus asked us to remember him. It's a time of remembrance. Again, we're told here in verse 19 that Jesus took the bread and gave thanks and broke it. And he gave it unto them, saying, "This is my body which is given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." This is a command. Do this in remembrance of me. So there's not only a physical aspect to communion when we physically take the bread and drink from the cup, but there's a mental aspect that's going on when communion takes place. In response to all that the Lord has done, Jesus asked us to remember him and what he has accomplished on the cross for you. Communion is not a time for you to check out, church. Not a time to walk through those doors and say, "Oh no, taking place, having communion." It's a time where you focus your mind. You focus your mind. You turn your eyes upon Jesus. you remember what he's accomplished for you. It's a time where you consciously call to mind the life that he lived and the work that he accomplished. It's a time for you to remember the price that he paid in order for your sins to be forgiven. It's a time where you recapture that love for him. You recapture the reality and the significance of what he's done for us. It's a time where you ponder the meaning of his life and his death and what it means to you. It's a time, I think, where you refresh your commitment to him. That's what communion's all about. And you anticipate his return. You starting to see the picture here? This is what we're to be doing as we partake in this memorial. We are to remember Christ and the cost of our redemption. We are to never forget, church. So there's a physical aspect to communion where we partake in the bread and the cup. There's a mental aspect to communion where we're consciously remembering what Christ has done. And then there's a spiritual aspect to communion where we are actually sharing in the benefits that flow from the cross. Listen carefully to what we're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 10, beginning in verse 16. And this is an obscure text. We're told here, the cup of blessing, which we bless, is it not the communion of the blood of Christ? The bread which we break, is it not the communion of the body of Christ? For we being many are one bread and one body, for we are all partakers of that one bread. Behold, Israel, after the flesh, are they not which ate of the sacrifices, partakers in the altar? Look at that last statement. Behold, Israel, after the flesh, are they not which eat of the sacrifices, partakers in the altar? So here the Bible says that under the old covenant, everyone became partakers in the altar. Everyone shared and benefited from what the priest did on that sacrificial altar. Everyone benefited from it. They enjoyed forgiveness of sin and being restored to fellowship with God. They enjoyed the spiritual benefits that flowed from the blood of the altar. And the same thing takes place during communion. When we eat the bread and drink the cup, we physically are enjoying the spiritual blessings that flow from the cross. The cross is the New Testament altar. It is the altar. It is the altar. And as believers, we share in the blessings that flow from the cross. We are nourished from all the benefits that flow from the crimson blood of Christ. When we eat the bread and drink the cup, we are taking into our lives the benefits of the cross. Everything that flows from the cross. And you say, well, what benefits flow from the cross? Well, how about peace with God this morning? How about joy in Christ? Hope in the future. Freedom from fear. Security in adversity. How about that? Hope in the future. All these things flow from the cross. Healing from sickness. It all comes from the cross. Victory over death, hell, and the grave. It's all flowing from the blood of the cross. All these blessings flow. And when you remember his redemptive work, you are nourished by them. You're being fed. By participating in communion, you're feasting on all these promises that flow from the blood of Christ. What a privilege it is to participate in communion. What a privilege it is this morning. But it's a privilege that's only reserved for believers. Only for believers. Just like baptism. It's only reserved for those who have consciously put their faith in Christ. It's not an act that unbelievers can participate in. Okay? It's not. Now, unbelievers may be present, and if you're an unbeliever here this morning, we welcome you. We welcome you into our midst. There's nothing secretive. We're not doing anything secretive here when it comes to communion. It's to be done in public. That's the beauty of communion. It's not a secretive or cultural ritual, a cultic ritual that carries some sort of magical powers. It's a public act of worship. That's what communion is. A public act of worship by those who profess Christ as their Lord and Savior. When you partake in communion, you are proclaiming the gospel this morning. You're proclaiming it. It's a proclamation to the entire world. You are proclaiming the Lord's death until He returns, unashamedly for all to see. We're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 24, and when He had given thanks, Jesus broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is My body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of Me." After the same manner, He also took the cup when He had supped, saying, "This cup is the New Testament in My blood. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of Me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until He comes." So by participating in this memorial, you are proclaiming the life and death of Jesus Christ. That's what you're doing. Now, unfortunately, the modern church gets caught up in all the wrong things when it comes to communion, I think. Church squabbles over what type of bread and what should be in the cup. Whether it should be wine or grape juice. And none of those things are specified in the Scriptures. At least I couldn't find them. The type of bread is not mentioned, and the only statement regarding what should be found in the cup is there in verse 18 of our text, where Jesus alludes to it as the fruit of the vine. So it can be wine or grape juice. So the Lord gives, I think, the church flexibility. I think He's vague for a reason here. He gives us flexibility when it comes to honoring this ordinance. Doesn't really matter this morning. What matters is what it represents. We're also given the flexibility, I think, when it comes to how often we're to carry out this ordinance. Some churches do it every week. Some once a month, some quarterly. But here at Hope, we do it a little differently. I'm not scheduling communion. I'm just not. We're going to do communion whenever the Lord lays it on my heart. I don't want it to become a ritual. I don't want us to become a bunch of Pharisees this morning, going through the motions of church. If you want to partake in communion, then you've got to be here on a regular basis. That's all I can say. I think this marks the third or fourth time this year. But regardless of how often we do it and how we do it, it is to be done with reverence and respect, church. Reverence and respect. I want you to listen very carefully to what we're told in 1 Corinthians chapter 11, beginning in verse 27. We're told, "Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink this cup, you are proclaiming the Lord's death until He comes. Wherefore, whosoever shall eat this bread and drink of this cup unworthily shall be guilty of the body and the blood of the Lord. But let a man examine himself, and so let him eat of that bread and drink of that cup. For he that eateth and drinketh unworthily eateth and drinketh damnation to himself, not discerning the Lord's body. For this cause many are weak and sickly among you, and many sleep. For if we would judge ourselves, we should not be judged. But when we are judged, we are chastised by the Lord that we should not be condemned with the world. Now I want to preference everything that I'm about to say with this. None of us are worthy this morning. None of us are worthy. None of us are worthy of what Christ endured on the cross. But what the Bible is speaking of here is participating in communion in an unworthy manner, in an unworthy fashion. And let me define that for you, what unworthy looks like. If you're saying in your heart this morning that communion is irrelevant or unimportant, don't you partake, because you'd be drinking unworthily. If you're just going through the motions this morning because the person beside you is doing it, going through the motions without understanding the significance of what's about to take place, then you're observing the Lord's table unworthily. If you refuse to confess and repent of sin, then you're partaking in an unworthy manner. So if you have sin in your life, we all do, we are to confess it this morning. It needs to be addressed in our time of reflection before we partake in the table. If not, you're drinking unworthily here today. If you show a lack of respect to God or to those around you during this time, you are drinking in an unworthy manner. So this morning, if you have a hat on, I'm going to ask that you kindly remove it. We're in the Lord's house and we're getting ready to come to the Lord's table. And we need to show some respect this morning. If you're here this morning and you feel like you're going to need to talk, during the next few minutes, I'm going to ask that you step out of the church this morning. It's disrespectful to God and it's disrespectful to those around you. There should be no talking during communion. And I don't care how long you've been a Christian, you still haven't arrived yet. If you're talking during communion, you're making a mockery of this ordinance, a mockery of what Christ has done on the cross. If you're talking, here's what I know: you're not remembering Christ. I know that much. And you're not reflecting on what he's done for you. This is a time where we remember Christ and we remember what he's accomplished for us. It's also a time, like I mentioned earlier, of self-examination. The Bible says that we are to be examining ourselves. You're to be looking at your own life. Don't worry about the other people in the room. You've got enough problems on your own to deal with. Self-examination. You're to be looking at your own life, examining your own heart, examining your own motives, examining your attitude towards the Lord, towards other people, towards this table. That's what's to be going on. The Bible says here the reason so many believers are weak and sick is because they are participating or have participated in this memorial in an unworthy manner. And the Bible goes on to say here in 1 Corinthians that God actually takes the life of believers who do so in some cases in order to protect them from eternal damnation. He takes people out so that they would not suffer the same judgment as the rest of the world. If that's not reason enough to see the seriousness, then I don't know what is. Let me show you what communion should look like for each of us here today. Jesus says in Luke chapter 18, beginning in verse 10, two men went up to the temple to pray. The one a Pharisee, a religious man, and the other a publican, just an old sinful tax collector. The Pharisee, the religious man, stood and prayed this to himself: God, I thank thee that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this tax collector. I fast twice a week. Look at me. I give tithes of all that I possess. It's all mine. And the publican, standing afar off, would not so much as lift his eyes to heaven, but beat upon his chest, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. Jesus says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone who exalts himself shall be humbled, and he that humbles himself shall be exalted. This is what we should be doing as we partake in communion. Right here. This is a picture. We should be bowing our heads, beating our chest, crying out, God, be merciful, because I'm a sinner. I'm a sinner. We should be confessing our sin and clearing the air with God, turning our attention on Christ and the sacrifice that He's made for us. We are to remember. And then and only then are we to eat the bread and drink the cup, so that we can leave here today feasting on the promises of God. Here in just a few moments, you're going to receive a cup. On one side of this cup is the bread. On the other side is the fruit of the vine. When you get your cup, go ahead and remove the cellophane from the bread. Okay? And I want you to hold that bread in your hands this morning, because it represents the body of Christ that was broken for you. I want you to think about that as you look at it. The body of Christ, the Lamb of God, broken for you. And I also want you to look down at that cup, and I want you to reflect on it, because it represents the blood that was shed in order for you to have forgiveness this morning, to have your sins separated as far as the east is from the west. It took the blood of Christ to do that. I want you to do that. But before we begin, I'm going to ask that you bow your heads. And I'm going to ask that we examine our own hearts, that we clear the air with God this morning. None of us deserve this. But God wants us to come freely to the table. So we can't have any sins, anything in our life that's holding us back. And if you're struggling this morning, just cry out to God like that tax collector. Say, God, I'm having trouble with this. Be merciful to me, a sinner. Forgive me and help me. Lord, I want to come to this table with a clean hands and a clean heart. Lord, I don't want to partake in it in an unworthy fashion. Lord, today we remember you. We remember remember you. Lord, we come to you this morning, thanking you for the Passover lamb. Thanking you for the blood that was shed on Calvary's Hill. And Father God, I pray that you'd forgive me of my sins, because you know they're many. Lord, that I'm not worthy to stand up here and preach your word, much less partaking this communion. But Lord, you are. Lord, you're worthy of our remembrance. The cost that was paid on Calvary. And Lord, right now in this moment, I pray that you would wash us clean, individually and collectively as a church. That you'd wash us as white as snow. And Lord, I pray that we'll remember you, Lord, because in this world it's so easy to forsake our love for you, forsake our first love. Lord, help us to turn our eyes upon Jesus this morning. Lord, I thank you for allowing us to begin to see the significance of what we're doing here. And Lord, I pray that we can all see it from front to back, from left to right. And what a privilege it is this morning for us unworthy sinners to partake in your Lord's Supper, Lord. What a privilege it is. And Father God, as we do it, we're proclaiming the gospel. We're proclaiming the life of your beloved Son, the sacrifice he made at Calvary. And Lord, we're doing it publicly for all to see with boldness, Lord. Lord, I thank you for this opportunity, Lord, and I pray that you'd bless it. And Lord, that you'd be pleased today with what we're doing here at the church. Father God, I ask these things in Christ's name. Amen. Scripture says, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "Take, eat, this is my body which is broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." After the same manner, he took the cup when he had supped, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. This do you as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." thank you for your reverence, your respect during this. And I pray that we now understand the significance of what we're doing here. And if you've been with us for any time, you know that we do it differently. At times we do it, we don't box ourselves in when it comes to anything here at Hope, and as well as communion as well. But thank you this morning for your reverence. I feel like we have honored the Lord's table this morning the way it deserves and demands to be honored. Over the last 2 weeks, we've had the privilege to partake in both ordinances that Christ has given to the church, and what a unique and opportunity it has been to be a part of that. And I thought it was only fitting that here on Memorial Day that we partake in this memorial and remember our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. God bless you for being here. I'm going to pray and you'll be dismissed. Remember the meaning of this weekend as we remember those who gave their lives, the ultimate sacrifice for us to have this freedom, for us to be able to gather here in this moment without our vets and without those who have valiantly fought in war times and not in war times. We would not have the freedoms that we have here today. So if you see a vet, thank them. I know we've got a number here in our midst today. And on that note, if you are a vet, I'm going to ask that you stand at this time. Go ahead and stand. Let's give these men and women opportunity. And I'm going to ask that we stand with them as we close this service here in prayer. Father God, we come to you this morning, Lord, and we thank you. Lord, we thank you for the sacrifice that you made, the ultimate sacrifice for each one of us here today. And Lord, we thank you for these men and women who sacrificed time away from family to help us have the freedoms that we have here in this country. Lord, freedoms that we all take for granted. And Father God, as we go out this place today, Lord, I pray that we have a renewed sense for what the Lord's table is all about, Lord, that we do see the significance of it. Lord, we thank you that we have had the opportunity the last 2 weeks to partake in these two ordinances, Lord, and we look forward to the next baptism. And Father God, we just pray that you just continue to pour out your hand of favor upon us. Lord, that you would continue to allow us to find favor in the eyes of the people, within the eyes of this community. And Father God, we're not perfect. Lord, we're far from it. But Lord, we are striving to honor you in everything that we do here at the church. And Lord, I pray that you find it pleasing this morning to what's taking place here today, what's taking place in the past, and what's going to take place in the future. And Lord, I thank you for every individual here today. Lord, for making this a priority in their lives this morning. Lord, I know they could have been doing a lot of other things today, but Lord, they've made being in your house a priority, Lord, and I pray that you bless them for it. And Lord, I pray that we all leave here, Lord, feasting on the promises that flow from the cross. Lord, we thank you. And Lord, we can't even fathom it yet. And Lord, we'll have all of eternity to ponder on it. Lord, I pray that until then, Lord, we be faithful here in this world, in this life. Lord, we ask all these things because we feel like it would glorify the name of Jesus. It's in his name I pray, and all of God's people said, amen.
Genesis 15. After the...
Never be more loved than I am right now. Wasn't holding you up, so there's nothing I can do to let you